come now to Thyatira, and you might think, well, why do we need a full session on just this one ecclesia? Well, I think you'll find out the reason for that when we're about halfway through. It is a subject that does require a little more time. You know, the Lord Jesus Christ said that he hated the deeds of the Nicolaitans. He doesn't compromise with the doctrine of Balaam. Now he's going to talk about Jezebel. And I want you to think hard about this. When the Lord says, I will place upon you no other burden to Thyatira, what do you think he's talking about? What do you think he's talking about? I will place upon you no other burden. The burden he's talking about is getting rid of the Jezebel class from the ecclesia. In the same way he required that they deal with the Balaamites and the Nicolaitans, he's saying, you've got Jezebel in your midst, and while she's there, I ain't walking among you for very long. Get rid of her. I place upon you no other burden but that. That's where we're going to arrive at, and we're going to see why he says that. Because if Jezebel was to remain, then Roman Catholicism would develop out of the Brotherhood. And guess what happened? Roman Catholicism developed out of the Brotherhood. Amazing! Pretty simple at the end of the day. Thyatira was the least notable city of all seven. Historians record little of it. In the 200 years before AD 96, when the messenger from John arrives with the letter from Christ. It was fortified by the Greeks as a military fortress because it stood in the Lycus Valley, which ran north and south, joining the Hermus and the Caicus Valleys. Losing its military significance in due time, during Roman times it became a large and prosperous commercial centre. We know that because, of course, there was someone quite notable here at one point, wasn't there? It was 80 kilometres or 50 odd miles east of Pergamos. Was that royal city's guard post to slow down invaders who came from the east? It was noted for its trade guilds. For example, the Guild of Dyers. And there was a lady who came to the truth, wasn't there, from this city in Acts chapter 16, converted by the Apostle Paul. And doubtless she took the truth back to the city of Thyatira, and Paul continued to encourage their growth and development while he was in Ephesus. He would have journeyed perhaps to some of these places and would have built up the ecclesia in Thyatira. Truth was started here, we believe, by the work of Lydia, Acts 16 and verse 14, encouraged by Paul, as we've said, when he was in Ephesus. Now here are the remnants of ancient Thyatira. So when you go there today, this is what you find. Just a few ruins from the past. And then the Lord Jesus Christ starts his letter in verse 18. He says this, and unto the angel of the ecclesia in Thyatira write, these things saith the Son of God, who hath his eyes like unto a flame of fire, and his feet are like fine brass. Now, why this phrase, the Son of God? This is not from chapter 1, is it? Have a look at chapter 1 and verse 13. In the midst of the seven lampstands, one like unto the Son of Man. Now, the Son of Man is a title of Christ which speaks of his delegated authority to judge on God's behalf. Want proof of that? John chapter 5, verses 26 to 29. Okay? Comes from Psalm 8. It's not about Jesus' humanity. The title Son of Man is not about his humanity. Okay? It's about his delegated authority from God to judge and to exercise dominion over carnal things in the earth. You know, one of the most prominent occurrences of this phrase, Son of Man, without the article, is in the book of Ezekiel. 91 times. What's Ezekiel about, do you think? Starts with the cherubim, finishes with Armageddon, building of the temple, establishment of the kingdom, all nations coming up to worship. What's that about? Christ exercising dominion in the earth, in the company with his bride, the second Adam. That's why he's called the Son of Man. This is a little aside, just to waste time. Why the title Son of God? Well, you see, in this chapter, he's going to point to a group in the Ecclesia of Thyatira who were called Jezebel. And Jezebel was a mother of harlots. She followed the example of Semiramis, the wife of Nimrod. And when Nimrod died, allegedly killed by a wild boar at age 40, she played around. She had another son, not by him. But she said he was Nimrod reincarnated. And because Nimrod was a god king, then Tammuz, sometimes known as Zoroaster, was the son of God. Oh, thus saith the Son of God. You got Jezebel in your ecclesia. And they think Tammuz, the reincarnation of Nimrod, is the son of God. Very, very appropriate opening, isn't it? And the next one's like unto it. Because now he is drawing from chapter 1. Eyes like unto a flame of fire. Verses 14 and 15 of chapter 1. Symbol, fire, in the scriptures, judgment. The anger of divine judgment. And what about the feet? Feet are like fine brass. Symbol for an immortal judge. John 5, verse 27. He'd given judgment into his hand because he is the Son of Man, purified man. Okay, he'll exercise dominion in the earth. Not a bad way to start to an ecclesia that's messing around with apostates. He's telling them something. He's on his way. And here comes the letter to Thyatira. You know, it says a few good things about this ecclesia. I know thy works and love and service and faith and patience and works. The last will be more than the first. Can't find an ecclesia like this in history, can you? Tremendous ecclesial works. And even more works and more works. Absolutely no good to you at the end of the day if you tolerate Jezebel. There'll be plenty of brethren from ecclesias that have had a history of good works that have given and given and given. Christ will say, don't know you. Because you tolerated Jezebel and she corrupted my way and people lost their lives. Not interested in your works. Sorry. Take them away on the left hand. Not interested. Works won't do you any good if you haven't got pristine truth at the judgment seat. Notwithstanding I have against you, notice it's different to what you've got in the AV in your Bible. You have a read of Revelation chapter 2 and verse 20. It says, notwithstanding I have a few things against thee. Well, you won't find a few things. You only find one. That's because in the Greek text there is no phrase, a few things. So you can cross it out. That's how it should read. Notwithstanding I have against them. He's only got one thing against them. Their toleration of the woman Jezebel. And we'll go on, we'll talk about all of this a little later on. So let's summarise. Even when the faithful know and do right things, an ecclesia can be endangered by false teachers. We must steadfastly hold fast to the faith once delivered to the saints, because only purity of truth will save at the end of the day. So here's our summary of the Lord's letter to the compromising ecclesia, Thyatira. They are commended by him for works, love and service, for faith and endurance, for more works, but criticise the toleration of a seducing Jezebel class who they wouldn't deal with and apparently didn't deal with. because she continued to grow until the apostasy grew out of the brotherhood. Now, you might recall that we mentioned that the Thyatira period, according to Brother Mansfield, is this period AD 606 to 1572, when true witnessing came to an end and Jezebel was ascended in the papal system. There is no hope of life without purity of doctrine. Now, I think we really do need to have a look at this passage here in 1 Timothy chapter 4. I know it's read quite frequently, but let's have a look at it again. 1 Timothy chapter 4, verses 12 to 16. We'll duck over verse 14 for time. Verse 12, he says this: "Let no man despise thy youth, but be thou an example of the believers in word, in manner of life, in love, in spirit, in faith, in purity. Till I come, give attendance to reading." Might I just pause there? Speak to the younger fellows, maybe younger brethren. When you're asked to read in the ecclesia, don't treat that lightly. Now, this is not an age of reading, is it? Our young people are not reading today. Paul's not talking here about reading a book in your bedroom at home, okay? He's talking about public reading of the Bible amongst the brethren. So brethren, young men, if you're ever asked to read, and you will be, because they start you there, don't they? You're ever asked to read, practice, practice, and get it right. Because if you read the Bible properly, it can have an effect just by itself. Those of you who've got Alexander Scorby and you listen to him know that's true, don't you? By the way, listen to Alexander Scorby read Job 19. If you don't get tears in your eyes, then your heart, you're a rock. He knows how to read the Bible. Okay? That's what Paul means here. "Till I come, give attendance to public reading of the Bible, to exhortation, to doctrine." You're going to come back to doctrine. Verse 15, "Meditate upon these things. Give thyself wholly to," that's why I said practice. "Give thyself wholly to them, that thy profiting may appear to all. Take heed unto thyself." You know, you can't help anybody until you've helped yourself. That's the first principle. You will not help anybody until you help yourself. "Take heed unto thyself, and unto the doctrine." So he brought doctrine up the list, hasn't he? "Unto the doctrine. Continue in them, for in doing this thou shalt both save thyself and them that hear thee." Could I give you the flip side of that? Don't put your heart into it. Don't worry about doctrine. Fiddle around with it. Mess around with it. And you'll lose yourself and them that hear you. That's the flip side of it. That's how vital doctrine is. So let's not play around with it. "Allowing error to be taught results in shipwreck." We had a look, didn't we, at 1 Timothy chapter 1, verses 19 to 20. "Proven teachers of error must be ejected." Paul says that in Titus 3, verses 1 to 11, after the first and second admonition. Reject, he says. You do it. You've got to go through a process. This is not about just tumbling people out the door. You've got to go through a process. You've got to establish that these things are fact. And they've got to be dug in on the other side. And when they're dug in, and there the twain will be. Can two walk together except they be agreed? You deal with it. That's what Paul says. Thyatira didn't bother. And Jezebel took over the brotherhood. That's history. Now, brothers and sisters, I want you to come back to Revelation 2. I'm going to go back to the roots. Apologies to those who were at Westerly the other night. They're going to get a little bit of what they heard, but I don't think they'll mind, because I bamboozled them then, so maybe this is a time to rectify. All of this in Revelation 2 comes from history. That's why Christ uses Jezebel. He just doesn't pick a name out of the air and say, "Oh, it'd be nice to call this class Jezebel." He picks Jezebel because of the history of Jezebel. Because this has all happened before. This kind of apostasy has happened in the ecclesia before. It's happening all over again. So let's have a look at it. Now, most of you are familiar, of course, with the history of the kings of Israel and Judah. It's not a great story in many ways, but there are some bright spots here and there. There are a couple of pretty bad ones as well. And here's one of them. The Babylonian apostasy in Israel, based in Samaria under the reign of Ahab and his filthy wife Jezebel. And the one in the times of Manasseh, son of Hezekiah, in Judah. Why did that have to happen? Why did it happen? Well, because, you see, God said there would be two women. One was Samaria and the other one was Jerusalem. And they would take the ephah of commercialized religion, or Judaism, and they would go to the land of Shinar and rebuild that system in the brotherhood. So what happened? So Zechariah 5 sees these two women, Samaria and Jerusalem, like storks flying to Shinar or Semiramis with an ephah, Judaism's commercialized religion. You know, that's how the apostasy grew in the brotherhood. You know why they pay the ministers in churches today? Well, because of Judaism. Commercialized religion. Because Judaism was installed, wasn't it, in the first century? It was never eradicated. So as time went on, these brethren who had this, you know, this ledger mentality, that if I do these good works and tick the boxes, all right, put all the good works on one side, and as long as they counterbalance my sins on the other side, God's in my debt, thank you very much, pay me. That's their mentality. They eventually said, well, why should I do this stuff for naught? So why should I work for naught? So when they travelled or spoke, I said, come on, give me. That's how you end up with a priesthood, gets paid. All right. That's how it came about. Right back here, from the captives in Babylon. The prophecy, the rise of the Roman Catholic apostasy out of the Ecclesia in the second and third centuries after Christ. And I say this quite often, never ever forget, brethren and sisters, that the Roman Catholic Church, which we're about to destroy in the company of Christ, came out of us. It came from Christadelphia. Never forget that. Okay, I want you to come back to the 1st of Kings 16. And when you get back to 1 Kings 16, I'm going to read you again Revelation chapter 2. For the sake of time, I'm going to ask you to do something while I'm reading. I want you to read 1 Kings chapter 16, and we'll get there eventually. I want you to read 1 Kings 16 from verse 30 through to the end of verse 1 of chapter 17. And I know you can do two things at once, so while you're reading, I'm going to read to you Revelation chapter 2, verses 20 to 23. It says this. Notwithstanding, I have against thee, because thou sufferest that woman Jezebel, which calleth herself a prophetess. And you're just reading about her, aren't you? In 1 Kings chapter 16, verse 31, okay? Calleth herself a prophetess to teach and to seduce my servants to commit fornication. You just read about Baal worship there, have you? That's the spiritual fornication that Christ is talking about. He goes on to say this. And to eat things sacrificed unto idols. You've just read about the temple of Baal, haven't you? It was reared up by Ahab. Verse 21. And I gave her space to repent of her fornication, and she repented not. You up to chapter 17, verse 1? How long did God give for her to repent? Well, for the period of the drought. That's why he sent a drought, doesn't it? How long was that? 3.5 years? I gave her space to repent. I sent Elijah the prophet. He declared there would be no dew nor rain these years except according to his word. And so it came to pass. 3.5 years, there wasn't a drop of rain. What then? Well, the events of Mount Carmel. What were they meant to achieve, do you reckon? And this didn't happen. But what were they meant to achieve? Did Jezebel come to Mount Carmel? No. Did Ahab come to Mount Carmel? Yes. Did Elijah run before Ahab's chariot back to Jezreel? Yes. What should Ahab and Elijah have done? Got rid of Jezebel. Right? What did Elijah end up doing? Well, she wanted to get rid of him, so he ran away to Horeb. That's what should have happened, shouldn't it? So God says, Christ says here in Revelation 2, "Behold, I will cast her into a bed, and them that commit adultery with her into great tribulation, except they repent of their deeds. And I will kill her children with death." What else would you kill them with, you reckon? What else would you kill them with? We're going to see why that statement is made in a moment. "And all the ecclesias shall know that I am he which searcheth the reins and the hearts, and I will give unto every one of you according to your works." So if you've read that history, and you've now got Christ's commentary on part of it, we need to explore why. Why has he gone back here? Why has he taken us back to Jezebel? Well, because, you see, apostasy came into the ecclesia of God through Jezebel in ancient times, and it was about to do the same again in the second century. Brothers and sisters, history does tend to repeat itself. Now, if you're back in 1 Kings 16, you will have read that Ahab was a great king. In fact, he was a great king of wickedness. But his father was also a very great king, Omri. We read about him, you go back to 23, this chapter, you go down to verse 28, you'll find Omri is a very powerful ruler. "He was the builder of Samaria and a statute maker for his son Ahab. And the formula of Micah chapter 6, verse 16, is seen in this partnership between Omri and his son." Now I haven't got time to take you to Micah 6:16, but this is what it says. "For the statutes of Omri are kept, and all the words of the house of Ahab." So Omri was a statute maker. As in, he wrote out a list. He was a doctrinaire. He said, "My son, this is what we're going to do in our kingdom." He dies, and his son implements the statutes of his father, Omri. You know where that comes from? Cush and Nimrod. Cush, as we're going to see in a moment, was the great original prophet of the Babylonian mysteries. Nimrod, his son, implemented them. Okay? That's where they come from, that statement. So here he is, Omri, the builder, the statute maker, and Ahab, the implementer of the ideologies of his father, and the builder, the rebuilder of Canaanite worship in the land of Israel. Baal worship. Baal, B-A-A-L. The Canaanite form of B-E-L, Bel. The title given to Cush. Three places in the Old Testament. Cush, Bel. Okay. So Ahab goes and marries Jezebel, this woman who has this unbelievably chaste. Okay. Daughter of Ephbaal, which means with or near Baal. She never left him. Never left Baal or Bel, Cush. And the restoration of Amoritish worship occurred through her getting behind Ahab and saying, "I want to do this. I want to build a temple to Baal. I want to do this." 1 Kings 21, verses 25 to 26 tells us about that. So we come and look a little bit further. "She is a mother of harlots and teacher of Baal worship," says Christ, effectively. And he uses her for that reason, because out of this class in the ecclesia came the Roman Catholic apostasy. Let me just show you how this formula works. I want you to come to 2 Chronicles chapter 22, verses 2 to 4. This formula of "the statutes of Omri are kept in all the works of the house of Ahab." 2 Chronicles 22, verses 2 to 4. Some of you all made this adjustment in your Bibles where it says 40 and 2 years old was Ahaziah. In fact, he was 22 years old. And you can look up the companion record. You find that he couldn't have been 42 anyway. He was 22 years of age. when he began to reign, and he reigned 1 year in Jerusalem. His mother's name also was Athaliah, the daughter of Omri. What's wrong with that? Well, Athaliah was not the daughter of Omri. She was the daughter of Ahab and Jezebel. Okay? So why does the record say she's the daughter of Omri? Well, you just got to read on. Verse 3. He also walked in the ways of the house of Ahab, for his mother was his counselor to do wickedly. You're starting to get your clues. Read the next verse. Wherefore he did evil in the sight of Yahweh, like the house of Ahab, for they were his counselors after the death of his father, to his destruction. The statutes of Omri are kept, and all the works of the house of Ahab. Statutes, instruction, doctrine always lead to works, outcomes. Omri laid down the statutes, Ahab practiced them. Cush laid down the doctrines of Catholicism, Nimrod and Semiramis practiced them. Okay? Athaliah ends up in Judah in the house of David. Guess what? Her son, Ahaziah, practices the works of the house of Ahab. Why? Because his mother is his counselor to do wickedly. Statutes of Omri. That's why she's called the daughter of Omri. Got it? You read your Bible carefully, it gives you its clues. Okay? So what we're looking at here is the history of Roman Catholicism. So does God have witnesses against this rising Baal worship, this Cush and Nimrod worship that's been brought back into Israel? Well, yes, he does. Just like in the Apocalypse, we're going to read of the two witnesses that Christ raised up, so to speak, against the Roman Catholic system. Who were they? Well, they were religious opposition to Rome and its church, and political opposition to Rome. Weren't they? It's exactly what he had in history. Who was God's religious witness? Well, it's pretty obvious, isn't it? 1 Kings chapter 17, verse 1. Elijah burst into the palace, the ivory palace of Ahab in Samaria, and says, "Thus saith Yahweh." What's that? It's a religious witness. Okay? So, I want you to come to Revelation chapter 11. We'll read from verse 2 to verse 6. Revelation 11, verse 2. But the cord which is without the temple leave out. In other words, it's the apostasy. And measure it not, for it is given unto the Gentiles and the holy city, the true ecclesia, now very small. Shall they tread underfoot 42 months? It's a reference to the period from the Phocan decrees in 608, 610. Through the loss of papal temporal power in 1868 and 1870. There's a different period. Read on, verse 3. And I will give power unto my two witnesses. This is religious and political opposition to Rome in its apostasy. And they shall prophesy 1,260 days clothed in sackcloth, that is persecuted. When does that start? Well, not the same time as the other one. And that's why you've got these two different descriptions for the same period or length of time. What's 42 months to a Hebrew? Hebrew's got 30 days in a month. What's 42 months? 1,260 days, isn't it? Same length of time, but described differently. Why? Because it's about a different period of time. This one's from AD 312, when the apostate Christian church supported Constantine against his enemies. Maxentius, whom he defeated at the Battle of the Milvian Bridge in AD 312. And from that time, the church demanded from Constantine a return. You know what the return was? We want your power against our internal enemies. These Christadelphians, we're going to get rid of them. You can help us. Give us the power. And he gave them the power. And for 1260 years, they brutalized our brothers and sisters using pagan, because it was pagan, wasn't it? They called it Christian. It was pagan Roman power against our brothers and sisters. And it terminated in 1572, exactly 1260 years later, with the massacre of St. Bartholomew's Day, when effective witnessing ended. Two different periods. So here's the two witnesses. Let's read on. Verse 4. These are the two olive trees and the two lampstands standing before the God of the earth. Who's that a reference to? The Pope. The Pontifex Maximus. How does he get that title? Got it from Cush and Nimrod. Okay. Here's these witnesses standing against the God of the earth. And if any man will hurt them, verse 5, fire proceedeth out of that fire and devoureth their enemies. And if any man will hurt them, and he must in this manner be killed, these have power to shut heaven that it rain not in the days of their prophecy. Hey, shut heaven? And when Ahab comes in, sorry, when Elijah comes into the palace of Ahab, says, there will not be dew nor rain these years, but according to my word, turns on his heels, boom, gone. How long? 3.5 years. 1260 days. 42 months. Accident? No. This is the Bible telling us that it's all happened before, brothers and sisters. What was happening in the days of Christ had happened before in the Ecclesia. Jezebel was present again. So God sent his religious witness. Now, does God have a political witness in the days of Ahab and Jezebel? Of course he does. His name is Obadiah. And you read about him in 1 Kings chapter 18. You know him, don't you? You know what his name means? The servant of Yahweh. You know what he was? The right-hand man of Ahab. And Ahab says to Obadiah, look, we're in desperate straits. Let's go out and see if we can find some grass to keep the remaining horses alive. So they go out, and Ahab goes one way by himself. Yeah, he did. He went the way of Baal. And Obadiah goes another way by himself. Yeah, he was going the way of Yahweh, because he was working against Ahab and Jezebel. He was saving God's prophets from Jezebel. And he took 100 of them by 50s, and he moved them from this cave to that cave, and he crept out at night. When his daily work was done as the right-hand man of Ahab, he's right in the government of Ahab, he creeps out at night and he goes up to the cave and says, here's some food. Look, they're getting close. Going to shift you tomorrow. He's a man right in the middle of government. And he's working against Ahab and Jezebel. You reckon God's got a political witness? He's got a religious witness? Got a political witness. Did Elijah know that Obadiah was on his side? In history, did the religious witness and the political witness know that they were witnesses? They know each other? No. Exactly what happened in history. That is how precise it is, brothers and sisters. No wonder the Lord Jesus Christ is back here. And you know the story, don't you? You know what happened. After the 3.5 years, they go to Mount Carmel. And Elijah calls down fire from heaven. And the whole nation collapses on their knees and says, Yahweh, he is God. They're ready. Ready to listen. But Elijah doesn't hang around, does he? He gets back to Jezreel, and Jezebel says, I'm going to cut your head off. Gone. What are you doing down here, Elijah? Says God to the prophet at Horeb. What are you doing here? Aren't you back there? We tend to mess it up, don't we? We do tend to mess up God's purpose at times. And Elijah messed it up. But what was this all about? Well, you see, In Matthew 24, verse 30, brothers and sisters, our Lord Jesus Christ said, "And then they shall see the sign of the Son of Man in heaven." That's a reference to Armageddon. Don't argue with that, because I want you to write down Revelation 1, verse 7 before you start arguing with me. I know there's different opinions about this, but there is no reason for difference of opinions. The Bible is clear. Have a look at Revelation 1, verse 7. And it will tell, and read the surrounding context. It will tell you what Matthew 24, verse 30 is about. It's about Armageddon. It's about the sign that God will give to his people that the time has come for divine judgments in the earth, and they need to get away from where they are and follow Elijah into the wilderness of the people, because they're going to be his weapon against who? Babylon the Great, Cush, and Nimrod, and Semiramis, and Jezebel. That's what it's about. So here we have a pattern that's laid out, judgments that were brought upon this system in the times of Ahab and Jezebel. And it's all there that we might see the work that we're about to do in the company with our Lord Jesus Christ, leading Israel back to the land through the wilderness of the peoples. Jezebel's the next slain. And 10 years after Armageddon, Rome's going to go down the girdler for good. They're given 10 years to sort themselves out. You haven't been in 10 years. They're going to create a rebellion. That's Psalm 2, isn't it? This is after Armageddon. Why do the nations tumultuously assemble? Why do they say, "We will not have this man to reign over us. Let us cast their bands asunder and break their cords from us." Yet, says Yahweh, "I've set my king upon my holy hill of Zion." Set my king? Yeah, the throne of David's at the foot of the exalted Mount Zion. And these idiots in Europe believe the doctrine of Antichrist that they're teaching their people right now, and follow the Pope to try and overthrow the King of the Jews. That's what they do in that 10 years. So Rome is the first to go down the girdler to signal the beginning of 30 years, the hour of divine judgment, until that system's been expunged from the earth. I asked someone, I'll come back to that point later. What does he do next? What does Jehu do next, by the way? Well, he annihilates the whole house of Ahab. Yeah, he gets rid of the lot. And that's the work of the 30 years of judgment upon European fools who follow the Pope against Christ. And then, of course, the final thing he does is he gathers every single Baal worshipper, and he makes sure there's no worshippers of Yahweh in this building. You know the story, don't you? He puts 80 men on the doors and says, "You let one of these go, and I'll take your head off." So nobody got out. And when they were finished, there was not one Baal worshipper left in Israel. And when you and I are finished, brothers and sisters, after 40 years from Armageddon, there will not be one single Roman Catholic on the earth. You know that? Not one. Don't forget where they came from. They came from us. And nobody is going to get the job of finishing them off who fiddles around with them and tolerates them. No one. Now, who's this man that does all this work? Well, his name's Jehu. It means Yah is he. You know what God gives to Jehu? I think this is quite remarkable. You know what God gives to Jehu? 4 generations on the throne of Israel, doesn't he? Well, I haven't got time to take you to that. But you know the story, don't you? Jehu wasn't a righteous man. He didn't turn away from the worship of Jeroboam. He got rid of Baal worship. But he didn't complete a reformation. But God says, "Now listen. Because you did what I said you had to do, your children will sit upon the throne of Israel for 4 generations, and then I'll finish you off." That's why Christ says, "Of the children of Jezebel, I will kill her children with death." The contrast is Jehu and his sons. See? Kill her children. What else would you kill them with? It's a way of saying permanent destruction. Revelation 19, verses 19. We can come back to Revelation now, can't we? I'm going to put this up just very quickly. I want to ask you a question. I've asked a few, so some of in the audience are quite familiar with this. In Revelation 19, we read in verse 20 about the ultimate destruction of the last two powers, just like the two horns on the beast of the earth, the last two powers that Christ destroys, apart from a bit of mopping up to be done, before he has universal rule over all the earth 40 years after Armageddon. I saw the beast and the kings of the earth and their armies gather together to make war against him that sat on the horse and against his army. Now we know, don't we? The previous verses describe Christ on a white horse. And we also know that behind him are the saints riding on white horses. And we know that they're saints because it says they're arrayed in fine linen, clean and white. And verse 8 tells us who they are. These were the ones who had been at the marriage of the Lamb. And their garments are clean and white. No doubt about who they are. Okay? Why a horse, do you think? Why a horse? Because you see, the horse is a symbol for Israel. And if you were to go back to the roots of Revelation chapter 19, and this is something that brethren can do in their own time, you go back to the roots of Revelation chapter 9, you'll find that those roots are in Isaiah chapter 63. And the language of Isaiah 63 is lifted out and woven through Revelation chapter 19. It's about the same thing. It's about the crushing of the winepress of the wrath of God. You'll read that in Revelation chapter 19 a little earlier on when it talks about our Lord Jesus Christ doing that precise work. It says in verse 15, and out of his mouth goeth a sharp sword. Sharp sword? This is the one in chapter 1. That with it he should smite the nations, and he shall rule them with a rod of iron. We'll come back to the rod of iron in a minute. And he treadeth the winepress of the fierceness and wrath of Almighty God. And here he is, brothers and sisters. Christ on a horse, his saints on horses. Let me ask you a question. How did Jezebel die? Well, two eunuchs. You know, Jesus says, who's with me? Two eunuchs put their head out the window. We are, right, toss her down. Second story window. So they get hold of it. Now you can imagine Jezebel, she'd spent 3 hours, you know, tidying herself up, painting her eyes and so on. She'd just stand there, wouldn't she, and say, well, yes, look, I'd like to fly, so just throw me out the window. Or do you reckon she'd fight like a cat? A wild cat. The latter. She fought him. She's scratching at the eyes of these eunuchs and they're trying to get her out the window. And as she's going out, she's grabbing a hole. And as she goes down, she's trying to grab the walls because it says there's blood on the wall. So she's thrashing as she goes down. So when she gets to the bottom, boom, it doesn't kill her. It might knock her out, might break her legs, we don't know. But it doesn't kill her. What kills Jezebel? Horses. Jehu drives his chariot horses over Jezebel. She's killed by horses. Brothers and sisters, the horse is a symbol for Israel. Proof? Isaiah 63, verses 12 and 13. This is where this all comes from. A brother in the audience, please, can you look up Isaiah 63, verses 12 and 13? Come out and stand out here so we can hear you. And read it out, please, while I go on. Because I need to go on. I'm going to talk about this. This is the chart that some of you will have seen. Begins with the resurrection of the dead. It goes through Christ's universal rule. 50-year period from the time that the dead are raised to the time that Christ walks his bride around the completed temple, the house of prayer for all nations. We know there will be a 40-year period of judgment from Armageddon. That leaves 10 years for the work of the judgment seat and the marriage of the Lamb and the preparation of the saints and all of these things that have to happen before Armageddon. And all the stuff that goes on, principally the second exodus of Israel and the 30-year hour of judgment upon Catholic Rome, because those two things are inextricably linked. Israel returning under Elijah is the weapon that Yahweh uses against Catholicism. Now, we've got a brother, got that passage open. Please, can you read it out for us with a loud voice?
That led them by the right hand of Moses with his glorious arm, dividing the water before them to make himself an everlasting name. That led them through the deep as a horse in the wilderness, that they should not stumble.
Exactly. He led them through the wilderness. Guess where Elijah brings Israel? To what's described in Revelation 17 verse 3 as the wilderness, in which the woman sits astride a scarlet-coloured beast. She's on many waters, which are peoples and nations and tongues. You know what Ezekiel chapter 20 verse 35 says about that? That when Elijah brings Israel out of the lands where they're dispersed, he brings them into the wilderness of the peoples, Europe. The hotbed of rebellion against the rule of Christ. How do they come to that wilderness? As a horse in the wilderness. Who's riding the horse? Christ and the saints. Christ and the saints. Okay? Your work and my work, brothers and sisters, to trample Jezebel to death. And do you reckon Christ would have meant when he says in Revelation chapter 2, let's go back to it. And he says this in verse 24. But unto you I say, and unto the rest in Thyatira, as many as have not this doctrine, which have not known the depths of Satan as they speak, I will put upon you none other burden, but that which ye have already. Hold fast till I come. You reckon he means by that? Now listen, brethren of Thyatira, I'm quite happy about you toying around with Jezebel. Why don't you put on a big dinner and, you know, tell her you love her. And we don't disfellowship anybody. We love you. We want, you know, we can tolerate you. You reckon he means that? I'll let you answer that question. Brothers and sisters, 2060 is the terminus of the papal system. Jezebel, Ahab, Nimrod, Cush, a whole lot of them will disappear from the earth by 2060. You want proof of that? Ask Brian King. And he'll take you to Daniel chapter 7, verse 8. And he'll make you look at Daniel 7 verses 23 to 26. And he'll point out that there's 1260 years there. He'll tell you that the three horns were plucked up by Pepin, King of France, in 758 AD and were given to the Pope, culminated in the development of the little horn that replaced them, the Holy Roman Empire. That's 800 AD, Christmas Day of that year. That system has 1260 years to run, and it runs out in 2060. And if there's a 50-year period between the resurrection of the dead and Christ walking his bride, which he can now display as his true bride because he's destroyed the false one who claims to be his bride and exposed her to be the harlot that she is, that's going to happen. Right, there's 50 years. Then somewhere, shortly after this event, he will walk his bride around the house. Now whether that will be a year, 2 years, I don't know. I know it won't be too long. That's why I believe we are a hair's breadth, and I mean it, we are a hair's breadth away from the return of Christ. Because you and I have got a job to do. And it's spelled out in Revelation chapter 2. You have a look. Verse 26. He that overcometh and keepeth my works unto the end, to him will I give power over the nations. And he shall rule them with a rod of iron. That's Revelation 19, isn't it? As the vessels of a potter shall they be broken to shivers, even as I received of my Father. And I'll give him the morning star. That's all coming from Psalm 2. Could I take you to Psalm 2? Yeah, I reckon I've got a few minutes. The brother over there is silent at the moment. So let's come to Psalm 2. Why do the nations rage and the peoples imagine a vain thing? The kings of the earth set themselves and the rulers take counsel together against Yahweh and against his Mashiach, his Messiah, saying, let us break their bands asunder and cast away their cords from us. He that sitteth in the heavens shall laugh. Yahweh shall have them in derision. Then shall he speak unto them in his wrath and vex them in his sore displeasure. Yet have I set my king upon my holy hill of Zion. Up to that point, I think we're pretty clear, aren't we? This is the 10-year period between Armageddon and the destruction of Rome. It's the time given to the nations to sort out what they want to do. I hear the message from the saints of Revelation 14, 6 and 7. Fear God, keep his commandments. Comes from here, brothers and sisters. That message comes from here. Their challenge. Most of them, sadly, will not listen. They'll listen to the Pope. Nimrod is more important to them than Christ. Go on, let's read on. Verse 8. God says to his anointed, whom he set upon his holy hill of Zion after Armageddon, ask of me, and I shall give thee the nations for thine inheritance, and the uttermost parts of the earth for thy possession. Thou shalt break them with a rod of iron. Thou shalt dash them in pieces like a potter's vessel. Eh? Ah, look. That's Revelation 2. He shall rule them with a rod of iron, as the vessels of a potter, till they be broken into shivers. See where that's coming from, can't you? He goes on to say this. Be wise now, therefore, O ye kings. Be instructed, ye judges of the earth. Serve Yahweh with fear. That's Revelation 14, verse 7. Kiss the Son, lest he be angry, and you perish from the way, when his wrath is kindled but a little. Blessed are all they that put their trust in him. Language clearly drawn in Psalm 2. You go to Thyatira today, brothers and sisters, this is what you find. There is no ecclesia there. There is a challenge, isn't there, in holding fast to the end. But there's a reward attached to it as well. Tomorrow morning, God willing, we'll have a look at the challenge of keeping our garments white.